The way you approach family life has a profound impact on how you live, if you're willing to work at it. And I know that for people with especially difficult families, it can be an incredible amount of work. Your family can become a source of stability and strength. A healthy, supportive family is like a safe haven in a storm. People have to deal with a lot of pressure these days. The workplace is demanding. Schools are often hostile environments. The pace of life is out of control. Where can a person find shelter in such a climate? If it is not at home, then it probably isn't anywhere. A reporter once asked President Theodore Roosevelt with whom did he enjoy spending most of his time. He responded he would rather spend time with his family than with any of the world's notables. For him and for his family, home was a safe haven in the midst of a storm. A healthy family also provides a photo album of memories. Think back to your own childhood. What are your favorite memories? What positive images still make you smile? If you have children, which of their memories do you think are their favorites? You may want to ask them. The more positive and loving the environment you strive to create at home, the more good memories they will have to keep them grounded. Your family can also be a crucible of character. Your family life not only helps to form the character of any children living at home, but it also continues to mold your character as an adult. Your character is little more than the collection of choices you make and the habits you cultivate every day. Since your family creates your primary environment, it influences those choices and habits. Strong, healthy families encourage people to make constructive choices, to develop positive disciplines, and to pay the price today for success tomorrow. And a supportive family is a treasure chest of your most important relationships. There's no doubt that the relationships you have with members of your immediate family and with your spouse are the most important ones in your life. The people closest to you form you and are formed by you. That should be reason enough to value them. When Mother Teresa received the Nobel Peace Prize, she was asked, "What can we do to promote world peace?" Her answer, "Go home and love your family." If you want to make a positive impact, no matter how far-reaching, start at home. Treat your family members like treasures. Years ago, I cut out a quote by Nick Stinnett that summarized the importance of family. It reads, "When you have a strong family life, you receive the message that you are loved, cared for, and important. The positive intake of love, affection, and respect gives you inner resources to deal with life more successfully." In other words, family gives you stability. In 1986, when I was 39 years old, I began to notice a terrible trend. The marriages of some of my colleagues, college buddies, and friends were falling apart and ending in divorce. That really got my attention because even some of the relationships that Margaret and I had considered to be strong had fallen by the wayside. We didn't think our relationship was in any kind of danger, but I also discovered that prior to their breakdowns, some of the couples had thought nothing like that could ever happen to them. This all occurred about the same time my career was really taking off. I still wanted to be successful, but I didn't want to lose my family in the process. That prompted me to make one of my key life decisions, and I would do so by rewriting my definition of success. From that moment, success meant having those closest to me love and respect me the most. I don't know where you stand with your family now. Everyone's situation is unique. You may have a great family life, or you may have made some serious mistakes from which you fear you will never recover. You may be single with no children, so that all you have is extended family. But I can tell you this, no matter what your situation is, you can benefit from the stability that comes from communicating with and caring for your family daily. Here's how to get started. Determine your priorities. There's a Russian proverb that gives this advice. Before going to war, pray once. Before going to sea, pray twice. Before getting married, pray three times. In other words, anytime you're going to engage in a great and potentially risky endeavor, give it serious consideration first. How else are you going to know where it ranks in priority in your life? I learned this lesson the hard way. In the space of 1 month in 1969, I graduated from college, got married to Margaret, and started my first job. As soon as we got back from our honeymoon, we moved to a new town, and I started working. I was the senior pastor of a small country church, and I was determined to be successful. I threw myself into the job, giving it everything I had. And when I say everything, I mean everything. I worked all day at the church, and every evening I set appointments to meet with people in the community. I worked a six-day work week, but I cheated by working on my day off too. Meanwhile, Margaret worked a couple of jobs to keep us going financially because my salary was so low. The problem was that I was neglecting her and our marriage. Margaret and I had known each other since high school, and we dated for 6 years before we got married. So we had a lot of history together, especially for a couple so young. Back then, I believed our history was going to carry us through while I devoted myself to my career. But a marriage can't survive forever on leftovers. It needs to be fed continually, or it will eventually starve. Decide on your philosophy. In the first decade of our marriage, Margaret and I decided on our personal philosophy of family. First, we tried to live it out as a couple. Then, when we had children, we worked to make it the foundation of our choices as parents. For us, the bottom line on family was for us to cultivate and maintain our commitment to God. Our faith came first in our lives. If we neglected or compromised that, nothing else would be of value. Our continual growth, reaching our personal potential and helping our children do the same, is one of our highest values. When we come to the end of our lives, we want to look back knowing that we lived life to the fullest. Our common experiences. The greatest bonds between people come as a result of their experiences together, both good and bad. We create as many positive experiences as we can, and we weather the negative ones together. Our confidence in God, ourselves, and others. Your belief determines how you will live, and it also impacts the outcome of everything that you do. And our contributions to life. People should try to leave the world a better place than they found it. We want to add value not only to the people in our family, but also to every other life we touch. I know that you will want to create your list. Here's my suggestion. Keep it simple. If you come up with a list of 17 things you want to live out, you won't be able to do it. You may not even be able to remember it. Whittle the list down to the non-negotiables. Develop your problem-solving strategy. I think a lot of people go into marriage expecting it to be easy. Maybe they've seen too many movies. Marriage isn't easy. Family isn't easy. Life isn't easy. Expect problems, stay committed, and develop a strategy for getting through the rough times. Some people call family meetings to discuss issues. Others create systems or rules. Use whatever kind of problem-solving strategy works for you. Just be sure that it fosters and promotes three things. 1, better understanding. 2, positive change. And 3, growing relationships. The desire to make your family a priority is one thing. Actually, living it out is something else. I found that it's often easier to get the approval of strangers and colleagues than it is to get respect from those who know you best. So I practice this discipline. Every day I work hard on gaining the love and respect of those closest to me. Years ago, when something exciting happened during the day or I heard a bit of interesting news, I'd share it with colleagues and friends. By the time I got home, I had little enthusiasm for sharing it with Margaret. So I purposely began keeping things to myself until I could share them with Margaret first. That way, she never got the leftovers. I found the best way to place my family first is to give them some of my best energy and attention. If you desire to strengthen your family life and make it a source of stability, then try practicing some of these disciplines. Put your family on your calendar first. I have found that my work will gobble up every bit of my time if I let it. Before I made the decision to make my family a priority, I didn't give them the time that I should have. I think that's true of most people who enjoy their careers. Other people have hobbies or interests that can be very time-consuming. If you don't create boundaries for how you spend your time, your family will always get the leftovers. Even today, if I let my guard down, I'm liable to let work take over my schedule. Someone once said that you should never let yourself feel that you ought to be at work when you're with your family, and you should never feel that you ought to be with your family when you're at work. That's a great perspective. If you and your family can figure out and agree on how much time you should spend together and you protect those times, you should be able to adopt that mindset. Try to create and maintain family traditions. Traditions give your family a shared history and a strong sense of identity. Don't you remember how your family celebrated Thanksgiving as a child, or how about Christmas? The traditions your family kept helped you define who you were and who your family was. Give thought to how you want to enjoy holidays, mark milestones, and celebrate rites of passage in your family. Start by basing traditions on your values. Add others you enjoyed from your childhood. If you're married, include those of your spouse as well. Mix in cultural elements if you want. Build some around your children's interest. Give traditions meaning and make them your own. It's vital to keep your marriage healthy. The relational foundation of any family is a couple's marriage. It sets the tone for the household and is the model relationship that children learn from more than any other. That's why former Notre Dame president Theodore Hesbaugh asserted, "The most important thing a father can do for his children is to love their mother." No marriage is easy to keep going. It's been said that a successful marriage is one that can go from crisis to crisis with a growth in commitment. That's what it's really all about. Commitment. Commitment is what carries you through. People who use their feelings as a barometer for the health of their marriage are destined for a breakup. If you intend to stay married only as long as you feel the love, you might as well give up. Just like anything else worth fighting for, marriage requires daily discipline and commitment. As I reflect on my family decision, I look back with intense gratitude to Margaret and my children. And I realize that in my 30s, my family decision gave me protection from making the life-shattering mistakes of many of my friends. In my 40s, my family decision helped me place my family first. In my 50s, my family decision has allowed me to see the positive outcome of the success of my grown children. For 18 years, my family and I have benefited from my decision to live by a different definition of success. I can't imagine what life would have been like without the stability provided by my family.